بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسوله محمد وآله وأصحابه أجمعين. Welcome again my dear beloved brothers and my dear sisters to another wonderful program entitled Ramadan Reminders. And as we begin, I would like to greet you with our greetings of peace by saying Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace, blessings and mercy of Allah be with each and every one of you. In yesterday's discussion, we touched on a very important topic regarding rights of servants, the servants of Allah, حقوق العباد. And under that general topic, we spoke about the rights that exist between the husband and the wife. And we also made it clear, as it is given in the Sharia, that the husband has certain rights over his wife, and the wife also has certain rights over her husband. When these rights are fulfilled, then inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the marriage will be a successful and a good one. And from among these rights, we were speaking about some of those things that were common between both of them, that each one has this right on the other one. So the husband has these rights on his wife, and the wife also has the same rights upon her husband. In this regard, this is the points we were making. And one, we have spoken about honesty and trustworthiness, and we have spoken about compassion, love, mercy among themselves. So therefore, it is important that the husband be honest to his wife, and the wife be honest to her husband also. So the right of the husband upon his wife in this case is that she must be honest to him. And the right of the wife over the husband in this case is that he must be honest to her. And like this, you know, we spoke about being trustworthy to each other, having that love and sharing that love, and being compassionate to each other, and also being merciful to each other. And another very important part or point, or we'll say a haq, a right, that is common to both of them is that of softness and leniency. Islam encourages us to be soft and lenient in all our dealings with respect to those people who are around us, with respect to our children, brothers and sisters, neighbors, etc. And more so, the one that you are living with, who in the case of the wife will be the husband, and in the case of the husband will be the wife. So it is required that that trait of softness and that of leniency exists in both of them, for both of them. It means that the husband must conduct himself and be with his wife in a way that he's lenient and he's soft and he's not harsh and he's not stern, and he doesn't treat his wife as if he is a king and she is a slave or a slave girl. And it should not happen that the wife also, she does not show that type of soft attitude and lenient behavior towards him, that she, it should not happen that she becomes harsh and stern in words or in actions, in response, in speaking, in interacting with each other. So the husband and the wife must be soft to each other in their dealings with each other, in their interactions with each other, in their, you know, while they do all their dealings, in other words, they must have that, you know, and they must not let anger becloud their thoughts and becloud their minds in thinking that which is right and blocking them from doing that which is good. This is a requirement of the Sharia. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one beautiful hadith says that household in which ra'fatun is placed, and ra'fa means softness and leniency, that house in which a leniency and softness is there and it exists, then this house is a house in which there is a great amount of goodness and khair. So therefore, it's only an account of that softness in behavior and conduct that both spouses should maintain and should have in dealing with each other. It will bring about love, it will bring about compassion, it will bring about goodness in the marriage. But if the husband is harsh, you know, most of the times, or all the times, and all the wife is the same, then how can this marriage be fruitful? How can they live together as a husband and wife? How can they communicate, and how can they, discuss issues and also decide on issues, even with respect to their children, to outsiders, to their own selves. So on account of this softness and leniency, it is required that if there is some fault or something that occurs from the wife, the husband should be willing to forgive it. Obviously, it would be understood what type of faults and mistakes can occur and what are those that are forgiven. Obviously, there are certain things that it is, you know, far beyond what is expected or what will be the normal thing that will occur in a marriage. So therefore, the normal living together where mistakes are made, errors are made, then both parties must bring themselves to that state where they are willing to forgive each other for those issues and petty minor issues that will normally occur. Obviously, both people, the husband and wife, they were strangers before. Now they have become married and they begin to live. Now they will begin to learn about each other in details, about the likes and dislikes of each other, the pattern of conduct and behavior of each other, the way of speech of each other, you know, what a person likes to do, at what time he or she likes to do it. All these things will now come in the open. Obviously, this of one person might not be agreeable and pleasing to the other, but then we must look that in certain things that are occurring, is one breaking the Sharia? Is one breaking the laws of Islam? Is it that one is guilty of doing something that is haram? Is it that one is taking away the haqq and the rights of the other one? Is it that one is oppressive and unjust to the other one? So when these things are not there, it means that there are no minor issues. It might be connected to cooking. It might be connected to the time of eating. Or there are so many things that come up between the husband-wife and relationship, and that is there and exists among them that only the husband and wife will know about it. But they must be looking at these things in this way. Is it a major issue that issue itself can cause about quarrels and disputes and arguments and a breakdown in the marriage? And is it something of such a nature that will actually want them to be separated from each other and want the wife to return back to her parents, or for the husband to desert her, leave her alone and walk out? We have to look at that, at husband and wife. You have to look to see if the issues or that issue that is coming up, is it so major? Is it so grave? Or it is probably a petty small issue that can be sorted out being soft and lenient to the other person, condoning, overlooking, and forgiving each other. So that if softness and leniency is there in the trait and as part of the conduct of a person, then much goodness will come about, because ra'fah in Islam itself is very great. And it brings about many, many fruitful results and very good ends it brings about. So therefore, husband and wife need to look at that. And as I said before, when it is there, then one will always be willing to forgive and overlook the faults of another. The husband will overlook and forgive, and also the wife will overlook and forgive, and they will mend up their ways and they will go again in the marriage, because the whole marriage life, it's a journey you are walking on. There will be little, you know, potholes, as we say, you know, there will be little humps to cross, obstacles may come in the way, but it's all about how both of them, they are ready and willing to deal with issues that may come up in the marriage. And when one person has that sifat, on that quality or trait of softness and leniency, then one will never find in his heart or her heart, in the case of the wife, to hate the other person. Hatred is not a part of a believer. In fact, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no Muslim must hate another. And he even went further than by saying, no husband should hate his wife. That should never come up. Yes, you may dislike something, but that dislike does not mean that it's hate. Hate is too grave of a word that should be used, and too grave of a trait that as a vice that should be in the life of a believer, a believing man, or a believing woman. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, a Muslim, a believing man who is a husband, must never hate his wife, and vice versa. The believing woman must never hate her husband. He says, if the husband sees in her something, some conduct or something that displeases him and makes him dislike that or the woman herself, then he can see in her many beautiful traits and good values that will make him love her and that will make him forget about that hate or dislike that may come to him. So therefore, anytime the teaching of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, two beautiful teachings that are incorporated in this beautiful tradition. Well, the first one is that a husband must never hate the wife and a wife must never hate the husband. That's number one. And by extension, no believing man must hate other believers. That should never be in the heart of a believer at all. Hate, malice, rancor, all these things, they are not such things that must be in the lives or in the heart of a Muslim at all. We must get rid of these things. So when a Muslim man and a Muslim woman, they do not have these things, then when they become married, then where will they get it from? It's not there. So they will not even entertain it and they will not even practice upon that vice of hate in the heart. So anyhow, that's the general teaching. The first one is that hate must not be there. And the second thing is that while both parties are living with each other, that's the husband and the wife, there would be instances and there will be situations and cases where someone does something that is not agreeable to the other. It's not pleasing to the other one. It can be a shortcoming on the part of one, or it can be a mistake that was committed, an error. So when that happens, what is required to be done? The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, if you see something, so speaking to the husband first, if the husband sees something in the wife that he does not like, that does not please him, then he should look at the other qualities and the traits and the beautiful conduct of his wife. And these things now, when he looks at that, he will like these things and it will make him forget that one thing that he would have seen. That's the way we have to look at it. Always look at the good of a person. Always look at the good traits and the good values of a person. And when we look at the good of a person, it will make us forget those small little bad things, shortcomings that may come from that person. And so to the wife, at times she may become upset or she may become displeased with the husband because of something that he did or he said. But at the same time, the teaching of the hadith is that she must look at his goodness. She must look at the good that he has given to her. She must look at the good that is in him. And every day and night, the amount of good that he extends to her and make the good things that she see in him overlook the shortcomings and overlook the faults that she may pick up in him. And in this way, if we practice on this hadith, then this can actually, you know, solve a lot of the problems that would normally come up between the husband and the wife. So that's another thing that is common between both of them, that one on one hand, the husband has a haq and a right on the wife, that the wife should show him softness and leniency in her dealings in all matters. And the wife also has a haq over the husband, that the husband should also be like that to him, to her, that he is not harsh, he doesn't have a bad temper, he doesn't behave in a manner that if he is acting as if he is the master and she is a slave, or vice versa, that the wife acts in a manner if she is the master of the house and he is a slave. This attitude, this type of conduct, it should never come about at all. Another thing which the beautiful deen has given to us as husband and wife, you know, that each person, he owes this to the other or she owes this to the husband, is that of not revealing the secrets and the faults of the other spouse. Very, very important. The husband, obviously living together, the husband may find out about his wife. Probably there are certain faults that she has, or there are certain things that probably she does, or she has bad habits or shortcomings that she would not like other people to know about that. But because of the fact that the husband and the wife, their relationship is so close with each other, they will find out about each other such matters and things that not even the parents of them, they know about it. Nobody, because they are the closest people now, the husband and wife. You can't hide from another person. If you try to hide, the truth always comes out on its own, revealed by someone, or it comes out openly. So the matter is that if the husband knows of certain things from her, and the wife knows of certain things from him that amounts to shortcomings and faults, each person must never reveal it to other people. You must conceal the faults of the other spouse. Because the husband, if you reveal the faults of your wife, then this is your wife. You wouldn't like other people to be talking about that all over the place, and then you will feel humiliated because it's your wife they are speaking about, and these faults have actually been revealed by your own self as the husband. You wouldn't feel good. Similarly, the wife. She may think that she might be doing something good by revealing his faults and shortcomings, probably to her parent, to his parents or her parents. Then they know about this. They will be speaking about it, but yet you continue to live with him. Then you will feel embarrassed. Even if a divorce takes place, then the faults of each other should never be revealed. This is something that is private. It's a private matter. They are confidential matters that a person must not go about. You know, the husband goes to his family and he starts to speak about his wife. She's like this and she's like this and she's like this and she doesn't do this. No, that should not be. And the wife goes about to her parents or other people or friends or family members and begin to reveal the shortcomings and the faults of the husband. Each and every single human being has faults. Nobody, no individual is perfect from among the human beings except the Anbiya's alayhimus salatu wasalam. So therefore we know we have faults. We must try our best to better ourselves so that we can move away from those faults and actually better ourselves with respect to our shortcomings. But the thing about it is, while these things are still in us, they must not be revealed to other people. And since the husband and wife, they are so close in this relationship of marriage, they will know more. So they may be tempted to say, even especially when one is angry with the other one for something, they may be tempted to tell somebody about something. So that is the way they should live. One not revealing the faults of the other one or the shortcomings. Now, sometimes there are problems in the marriage. And on account of the problems, they have to go, both parties will like to go for counseling. Or they are actually drifting apart. And for some reason, the husband has uttered a divorce, or the wife sought a faskhun nikah, or dissolution of the marriage, which probably she would have gotten, and they wish to reconcile. Or they're having problems and they want to separate. Or they're having problems and they want to fix these problems. So different situations come up when the husband and wife comes to somebody, whether it is a scholar, an Islamic scholar, or whether it is a counselor, or whether it is a mediator, whom they wish to help them. Now, even at that case, husbands and wife, they should stick to the points that are actually of concern. They should just stick to the problems that are affecting their marriage that they want to be solved. They should not go about just raking and scraping and picking up and showing this and showing that from 2 years and 3 years ago, from 15 years ago, and begin to speak about the other party and their family. You know, and her mother is like this, and her father is like this, or his mother is like this, or his father. No, that is totally haram. Those things are not connected to the issues that need to be solved. So don't mention it, because you will be revealing the faults of the other one. And then sometimes after having revealed all the faults, all the shortcomings and all the mistakes and errors of the other person, eventually right in the sitting there, you want to reconcile. But how the other party will feel? You know, if it is that the husband has revealed all these things about the wife and he wants to reconcile, how would the wife feel to reconcile with him when he has actually said so many things about him? And if it is that, you know, the wife had said all these things about the husband, which are not relevant to the issue at hand or the issues at hand,
And she wants to reconcile because she wants to save the marriage. How does she expect the husband now to want to reconcile and want to save the marriage after she has actually mentioned and revealed all the faults? So what those things that are pertinent and relevant to the issues that need to come up to solve the problem, to bring about a reconciliation, we should stick to that. And don't go into the personal. You know, the things that are personal, keep those things. That is secrets between both of you, the husband and wife. And it should not come about, even when you go for counseling, except that if you want correction of a certain thing, then in front of the spouse, you can reveal it. Or you can say to someone that this person has this problem, speak to that person. But the objective should always be for goodness to prevail, for goodness to come about, for correction to take place, and for a person to better himself or better herself. It should never be to bash the person, to condemn the person, to criticize the person, and to turn others against that person. It should never happen. So it all goes back to not revealing the faults and shortcomings of other people. If you do it for other people, then others will do it for you and about you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whosoever conceals from among the believers, whoever conceals the faults of his Muslim brother in this world, Allah will conceal his faults on the day of judgment. And whosoever reveals and discloses the faults and shortcomings of his Muslim brother, Allah will reveal and disclose his faults to everyone on the day of judgment, and everyone will become aware of the faults of this person. So therefore, that's a beautiful tradition that is connected to life in general, how we live as Muslims, and more so to the husband-wife relationship. So therefore, these are some things, as I mentioned before, there are certain things that are common, rights that are common between both parties. And therefore, each person should look towards fulfilling these rights. Inshallah, we'll close there today and continue tomorrow with the topic about the individual rights now, the rights of the husband over his wife and the rights of the wife over her husband. Inshallah, we'll continue with that discussion tomorrow. Until then, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all your acts of ibadat and your worship and your fasting and your tarawih salat and all the other acts of worship that you will do. May Allah accept these things from all of us. Wal akhir da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.